Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. So welcome to attend the symposium on development and innovation. This symposium is co-sponsored by the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences and the International Center for Trade and Sustainable Development. The Chinese Academy of Social Sciences is the national research center in the field of social sciences and humanity. At the same time, it's also the top think tank in China. So last year, 2016, when China functioned as the presidency of G20, the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences and its Institute of World Politics and the Economy ever organized some activities in cooperation with WTO and the International Center of Trade and Sustainable Development to discuss about global economic governance and some issues of common concerns. So this seminar is a further step further to expand and deepen the dialogue and the communication. We hope this seminar can enrich your understanding of Chinese economy and also to enhance the communication and dialogues concerning the global system of trade and investment. So today we have the special pleasure and honor to have His Excellency Mr. Jiang Jianguo, Minister of State Council Information Office in China, to attend this seminar and give his keynote speech. So now allow me to introduce the distinguished guests and experts present today. First of all, His Excellency Mr. Jiang Jianguo, Minister of the Information Office of State Council of China. His Excellency Yi Xiaojun, Deputy Director General of WTO. His Excellency Mr. Yu Jianhua, Permanent Representative and Ambassador of China to WTO. Mr. Zhang Fuhai, the Director General of the International Department of the Information Office of the State Council of China. Mr. Ricardo Melodi, International Center of Trade and Sustainable Development, Director of this center. Mr. Zhang Yuye, the Director General of the Institute of World Politics and the Economy of the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences. So today we are very honored and pleased to have also representatives from the Swiss research institutions, think tanks, and the delegates of the international organization based in Geneva, and also to have friends from media. So very welcome to this event. So now we have the pleasure to have Mr. Ricardo Melido to give his welcome remarks.
Thank you very much, Director General Wang Li, and good morning, everybody. I'm delighted to be here to have accepted the invitation of our colleagues at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, specifically the Institute of World Economics and Politics, and his director, our friend Yuan Chang. And it's a great pleasure for me to welcome State Council Minister Yang Wu Yang, as well as his colleagues, Ambassador Yu of China, as well as Ambassador Yi, Deputy Director General of the WTO. There's an issue with translation, interpretation.
It works?
Okay. we would also have during the day colleagues from UNCTAD, from Brookings India, our former colleague Harsha Singh, and from the WTO. And I'm again very thankful to all of you for accepting this invitation to be with us. It's particularly interesting to sit here at the WTO today at the very start of 2017, just a week before the very expected inauguration of a new U.S. president, and in the eve of the debates at the World Economic Forum in Davos next week, to be attended by President Xi Jinping. It's also particularly interesting to have the opportunity to look at the challenges that confront us this year when we think about the political events and electoral debate in 2016 in many places around the world, and how they have made prospecting for 2017 terribly perplexing. A year ago, many of us were here in the court of multilateral institutions, or the court of multilateral institutions, celebrating the achievements of the international community at the end of 2015, particularly with respect to global governance, the universal adoption of Agenda 2030 and the Sustainable Development Goals at the UN, the Paris Agreement on climate change, and a forward-moving outcome at the WTO ministerial in Nairobi had just happened, and it all filled us then with great excitement. It felt many ways as if progress had been confirmed. And I refer to what French economist Jean Pisani-Ferry calls faith in progress, which has been a key provision of the political and social contract of the post-war decades. Today, the feeling, and I think it's obvious to anyone following the news in the past few weeks, is necessarily different. Some of the events in 2016 point towards heightened challenges that come from geopolitics, from the functioning of markets, from threats to the natural environment, as well as from disruptions in technology. The share of global GDP of major economies, but of most economies around the world, has significantly shifted in the past three, four decades, and have now placed us in a different world when it comes to terms of competitiveness. Market expansion and economic globalization is now very acutely facing new headwinds and persisting structural difficulties in some of the major economies. And environmental challenges are unprecedented in their urgency, but also in the pace of the response, which doesn't seem to cope with that urgency. We have now also understood that disrupting technologies, particularly automation and technologies that have brought about many benefits through globalization, continue to test the ability of policy making both at the national level and at the global level, and that we're again not really coping with that pace of change. In today's world, public policy challenges regarding the stewardship of public goods, public aspirations, and the natural environment must be understood from a perspective of the dynamics of integration of national economies into global markets. In this context, a reference for analysis has been provided by the inclusively crafted and universally adopted, endorsed Sustainable Development Goals and their incorporation in this Agenda 2030. ICTSD was conceived and organized 20 years ago to seek alignment of international trade and investment policy and international frameworks with the high ideals that were then agreed in 1992 under the concept of sustainable development. In this way, ICTSD work is informed by a narrative that enunciates global integration in the service and support of the objectives of social equity, environmental integrity, and economic prosperity. ICTSD works towards ensuring that the agreements that govern the international economy and from which countries derive their policies lead societies in that direction. We're aware of how these frameworks increasingly determine allocation and use of natural resources outside and within national jurisdictions. In the context of today, we feel a heightened responsibility to help stakeholders and governments understand how to better work with existing institutions and frameworks that ensured cooperation at the multilateral level. Those frameworks may see their resilience tested in the months and perhaps years to come. That's a possibility. The other possibility is that we take a path that continues the progress and towards the definition of progress, again, that we have all worked towards. China joining the WTO in 2001 endorsed the prevailing liberal economic order that has underpinned that progress. Our hope and our mission in the months and years to come is to, again, work with all of you to make sure that the disruptions that we're living through and the challenges that we're facing and that seem to be all coming as in a perfect storm in the past few weeks, at least in terms of expectation, do not try that resilient in ways that are destructive, but rather constructive. And this is where we believe that innovation, in an institutional sense, from the policy perspective, as well as from the technology and economics point of view, is absolutely critical as a theme to follow. We have followed China's performance as a member of the WTO in the past 20 years, before its inception and since its inception 15 years ago. And we are impressed by its capacity to innovate. A few examples have to do with the way in which China has introduced reforms, first in the context of special economic zones and other configurations, and later on expanding them through its territory. More recently, the innovation that it followed in Shanghai with respect to foreign direct investment, and the implementation this year of an emission trading schemes to deal with carbon markets and help confront climate change are a few examples of that capacity to innovate. At the international level, the most
国际一层最为有意思的一个遵循的这个例子呢，就是习近平主席
overwhelmingly large initiative to integrate China through corridors, maritime and terrestrial, in that so-called OBORD, or One Road, One Belt, One Road initiative. And so we're expecting much again from China, now as the largest trading nation and as the second largest economy in the world, to lead in that innovation and to serve again as a guardian of the institutional order that we now have in place. So thank you very much for that opportunity. And I look forward to the remarks from Minister Jiang and the debate. Thanks.
Yeah, thank you very much, Mr. Ricardo, for your opening remarks, and also thanks for the collaboration of ICTSD in organizing this important event. Now we have the pleasure to invite His Excellency Mr. Yi Xiaojun, Deputy Director General of WTO, to deliver his opening remarks. Welcome.
The Honorable Minister Jiang, Ambassador Yu, Mr. Ricardo Melendez-Ortiz, ladies and gentlemen, thank you for inviting me to be part of this important and timely event. As mentioned by Ricardo a moment ago, 2 years ago, the international community set itself extraordinarily ambitious and far-reaching sustainable development goals for 2030. Goals that, by definition, can only be achieved in an innovative, productive, and a dynamic global economy. Given the continuing signs of slow global economic growth, rediscovering and reinvigorating the driving engines of innovation are especially critical. Let me make three observations about where trade and in the multilateral trading system can play key roles. First, innovation fundamentally hinges on economic openness. Open trade and investment help to create an environment conducive to innovation by encouraging the free flow of technologies across borders, by generating competitive pressures to modernize and improve, and by opening up new market opportunities for innovative products and services. The global exchange of trade investment is inseparable from the global exchange of ideas and know-how. There's clear evidence showing that firms linked to the global market are more innovative, and that being part of global value chains improves access to technology. Second, global cooperation is critical to economic openness. And here, the WTO plays an increasingly central role. It is hardly coincidental that the extraordinary expansion of the world economy since 1945 and even more dramatic rise of key developing countries in recent decades has gone hand in hand with the widening and the deepening of the multilateral trading system. Similarly, as the world economy has grown more open and integrated, it has reinforced the logic of and the need for even more trade cooperation and rules. This is becoming especially true in today's era of global value chains and the borderless digital commerce. The reality is that in an increasingly open, multipolar, and hyper-connected global economy, the WTO is becoming more, not less, important. Finally, and perhaps most importantly, advancing an innovative, open, and cooperative world trading system depends on ensuring that its benefits are widely shared. This means helping those countries and those groups within countries that are still on the margins of the global economy to integrate, adapt, and thrive by, for example, improving trade opportunities for SMEs and providing more effective adjustment assistance and training for dislocated or displaced workers and communities. The multilateral trading system's success in encouraging innovation, development, and growth is the result, not the cause, of countries' desire to cooperate on trade and to deepen their interdependence. Whether the system continues to succeed will depend on the support of countries and their citizens as well. Innovation is crucial for the global economy because it generates productivity, which in turn generates growth, development, and rising living standards. Innovation, trade, and growth are not the only conditions for development, but they are necessary conditions, which explains why countries, including China, that have successfully harnessed trade and investment for development, have also made enormous strides in improving health, educational attainment, and poverty reduction. Encouraging innovation and development by strengthening global economic openness and by resisting protectionism is one of the central challenges of our era. This seminar is absolutely right to underscore this importance. I wish this meeting a full success. I thank you.
Thank you very much for His Excellency's opening remarks and also his very in-depth observation analysis concerning the important role of innovation playing in development and also the significance of multilateral trading systems' significant function in promoting development. Together with ICTSD, we also are very grateful for the WTO's generous support in hosting this event in the venue of the headquarters of WTO. Thank you very much. Now we have the honor to invite His Excellency Yu Jianhua, Permanent Representative and Ambassador of China to WTO. The floor is yours.
Thank you very much. 尊敬的蒋经国部长,
Distinguished Minister Jiang Jianguo.
Gentlemen, friends, good morning and a happy new year to you. I am very honored to attend today's symposium. On behalf of China's permanent mission to the WTO, I warmly welcome Minister Jiang Jianguo, all experts and participants to this symposium, and expect to hear your insightful views and comments. At the very beginning of this new year, we are seeing certain good signs of recovery in the world economy, but we still cannot be optimistic for the whole picture, as recoveries of various economies remain unbalanced, trade and investment are still going sluggish, and particularly sentiment of anti-globalization is surging. At this critical juncture, this meeting is held timely with the theme of innovation and development in the evolution of global trade and investment cooperation. Here, I would like to share with you some of my observations. First, innovation is a perpetual driving force for human progress and a major source for economic growth. Innovation remains to be one of the most important policy tools for all countries, which is utilized to tackle numerous challenges faced by the global economy. Currently, innovation is increasingly booming worldwide, with the new technologies showing up at accelerated pace. This new reality is bringing revolutionary challenges to all countries and having deep impact upon the existing world pattern. Likewise, innovation has gradually changed the traditional elements of globalization. For instance, e-commerce and 3D printing are altering the means of trade, and the more flow of trade replaced by flow of data. Moreover, innovation is existing impact upon the existing division of labor and the competitive advantages of various nations, accelerating the upgrading of industries and changes in employment. Such a trend will inevitably influence the flow of transnational investment, which would be diverted more to the areas of R&D services and AI manufacturing in the future. This is why we need to vigorously promote innovation in the major areas of technology, institutions, and trade and investment policies. Second, we need to actively promote innovation of global governance. Currently, there have been emerging trends of protectionism, fragmentation of international rules, and anti-globalization rhetoric in certain countries and regions, which are extremely unfavorable for innovation and its utilization worldwide. As such, promoting global innovative development has become a critically important task for the multilateral trading system. Since 1995, the WTO has successfully created a rule-based, equitable, and transparent business environment for innovative development of all members. 36 economies have joined WTO in the past two decades, including China. These new members have become important driving forces of promoting innovation and trade liberalization and development. New issues such as global value chain, e-commerce, and investment facilitation are drawing more attention from members and having significant influence upon innovation and development. Third, innovation needs international cooperation. By enhancing cooperation on innovation among all countries, we can better boost innovation, create new trade and investment flow, revitalizing and upgrade the global economy, ultimately achieving the sustainable development goal. I believe that globalization will remain to be the right option for all countries. As we are entering the age of information with the interconnectivity and the digitalization, all countries have become an integrated community of common benefits and destiny. We are dependent upon each other, and no one can achieve prosperity without help from others. China's President Xi Jinping has highlighted the concept of community of shared future of mankind. It is a global perspective beyond nations, countries, and ideologies. The core concept is to envisage and create a vision of development featuring openness, innovation, inclusiveness, and mutual benefits. We should strengthen the rule-based multilateral trading system, advance the liberalization and facilitation of international trade and investment, making globalization benefit all countries and the trade benefit all people. Ladies and gentlemen, China is now implementing the strategy of innovation-driven development and pursuing the development ideas of innovation, coordination, green, opening up, and sharing. China is always a staunch supporter of globalization and the multilateral trading system. China's development itself is a process of continuous opening up and integration into globalization. We are actively expanding our market opening and trade liberalization, and joining efforts with other WTO members to preserve the multilateral trading system and boost liberalization and facilitation of trade and investment. In this regard, China has made huge efforts and significant contributions in the past decades. Before concluding, I would sincerely hope today's symposium offers a good opportunity for all experts to express their views and give their advice for the theme of innovation and development. I believe that with all the joint efforts, we can together make this year of 2017 a year of achievement for global innovation and sustainable development. Here, I wish today's symposium a great success. Thank you very much for your attention.
Thank you very much. Ambassador Yu Jianhua, thanks for your opening remarks. Now we have the special honor and the pleasure to have His Excellency Mr. Jiang Jianguo, Minister of the State Council Information Office of China, to give the keynote speech. 下面我们有请蒋建国部长
演讲。有请。
尊敬的，以下。
Distinguished Deputy Director General Mr. Yi Xiaochun, Distinguished Ambassador Yu Jianhua, and Distinguished Ricardo Ortiz. And because I've got a bit of a cold, therefore I cannot raise my voice, my sincere apology in advance. As you all know, Chinese President Xi Jinping will pay a state visit to Switzerland soon, where he will attend the World Economic Forum, visit the UN headquarters in Geneva, the WHO headquarters, and the IOC headquarters. As you also know, 9 years have passed since the global financial crisis broke out, with the rise of populism, protectionism, and nativism. The world has come to a historical crossroad where one road leads to war, poverty, confrontation, domination, while the other leads to peace, development, cooperation, and win-win solutions. Furthermore, Mr. President Xi Jinping is coming for peace and development, for win-win cooperation, for economic globalization, and for building a human community of shared destiny. History and current reality have proven that a sound global economic governance order is impossible without sound national economic governing systems. To make the global economy more sustainable and inclusive, therefore, it is urgent for all countries to take actions, develop themselves well, better coordinate their policies and stances, seek the largest common ground, and make joint contribution to stabilizing and improving global economic governance. So how did China do in that respect? And this is what I would like to introduce to you all today. Number one, the Chinese economy has entered a new normal featuring slow but steady growth. As China's economic volume grows bigger and its cooperation with the rest of the world grows deeper, the trend of the Chinese economy is capturing close attention from the world. In recent years, China's economic development has entered a new normal characterized by lower growth rate, faster structural adjustment, and a change of growth drive. On the one hand, the reduction in potential economic growth rate led to the reduction in actual GDP growth rate, which dropped from 7.9% in 2012 to 6.7% slowly in the first three quarters of 2016, but the general economy is stabilizing amid slow growth. On the other, China's economic development has seen many positive changes and is picking up amid stability. Such an economic state is reflected by the continuous improvement of people's living standards. From 2010 to 2015, Chinese people's consumption rate rose from 35.9 to 38.5%, averaging 0.52 percentage point per year. From January to November 2016, 12.49 million people found jobs in cities and towns nationwide, accomplishing 124.9% of the annual target. In the first three quarters of 2016, the national per capita disposable income increased 6.3% in real terms. People's salary, net operating revenue, and net property income all increased by about 8%, and a per capita net transfer income increased by 10.3%. More than 10 million people had been lifted out of poverty since the targeted poverty alleviation campaign was launched a year ago. The integration of medical insurance in urban and rural areas was accelerated. And this economic state is also reflected by the steady improvement of the economic structure. The growth of service industry contributed 58.5% to national economic growth in the first three quarters of 2016 and became the main engine for growth, while consumption contributed 71% to GDP growth, playing an even bigger role as a pull factor. From January to November, investment in high-tech industries increased 15.9% year-on-year, 7.6 percentage points faster than general investment. Profits in equipment and high-tech manufacturing increased faster, and iron and steel and coal sectors overfulfilled the annual capacity target ahead of schedule. The asset liability ratio of industrial enterprises dropped 0.6 percentage points year on year. This economic state is also reflected in the growing driving force of innovation. The national R&D capital intensity in 2015 was 2.07%, and China's R&D investment ranked second in the world. It filed more than 1 million patent applications that year, which is the most in the world. In the first three quarters of 2016, strategic emerging industries and high-tech ones maintained a 10-point-plus growth rate. Industry and internet were deeply integrated, a new economy featuring new industries, technologies, business forms, products, and models was emerging, and there was a stronger motivation for manufacturing transformation and upgrade. Despite its reduced economic growth rate, China remains one of the fastest growing economies in the world and a source of driving force for global economic growth. In 2016, it was the primary engine of world economic growth by contributing nearly 40% to it. As the world's second largest economy, China's economy is stabilizing and progressing amid slow growth, and it is the stabilizer that keeps the global economy sustainable. Meanwhile, the quality and benefits of China's economic development are enhanced, which will unleash more market demand, boost more investment, provide more products, and create more valuable opportunities for cooperation around the world. The second I would like to share with you is that China will create new landscape with new development concepts and contribute Chinese wisdom to global economic development. On the basis of making the scientific judgment that Chinese economy development has entered a new normal, our President Xi Jinping proposed the philosophy of innovative, coordinated, green, open, and shared development, under which China formulated the outline of the 13th five-year plan. Innovation is the primary driving force for development. The new philosophy puts innovation as the heart of China's overall development in order to continuously enhance the innovation capability and foster a sustainable driving force for long-term economic growth. Coordination is an integral quality of sustained and healthy development. It attaches more importance to ensuring equal access to development opportunities, balanced allocation of resources, and prevention of social conflicts and risks. Green is both a necessary condition for lasting development and an important way in which people can work to pursue a better life. China upholds the fundamental state policy of conserving resources and protecting the environment at its pursuits sustainable development. We will move forward with building beautiful China and make a new contribution to ensuring global eco-security. Opening up is vital for China's prosperity and development, adapting to China's ever-deepening integration into the world economy so that we can build a broader international communities of shared interests and proactively utilize and lead economic globalization. Sharing fully demonstrates the people-centered development philosophy. We must ensure that development is of the people, by the people, and for the people. We must give them a greater sense of gain as they contribute to development and share in its fruits and help them move steadily towards common prosperity. My dear friends, all theories are grey and the only tree of life remains forever green. In 2013,
the Chinese government rolled out 336 reform measures under 60 categories to deepen the reform. In the past year, China accomplished 97 key reform tasks on the central level and 194 on ministerial level, and 419 reform plans were launched by various parties. Among them, deepening supply-side structural reform is the leading measure to adapt to and lead the economic new normal. The focus is to improve the quality and efficiency of supply, improve the institutions and mechanisms for the market to play the decisive role in resource allocation, encourage and incentivize innovation more strongly, and raise labor productivity and total factor productivity. The ultimate goal is to meet people's rising material and cultural needs. In 2016, the supply-side structural reform focused on the five primary tasks of addressing overcapacity, reducing inventory, deleveraging, lowering costs, and bolstering areas of weakness. In 2017, China will continue to seek progress while working to keep economic performance stable and work hard on four aspects of supply-side structural reform, namely striving for further progress on the five primary tasks mentioned above, promoting supply-side structural reform in the agricultural sector, stepping up efforts to invigorate the real economy and promote stable and healthy real estate development, and properly addressing potential risks in such areas as finance, debt, real estate, and real economy. We have the confidence and capacity to achieve development with better quality, higher efficiency, more equity, and greater sustainability. As a developing country with a population of more than 1.3 billion, China is making tremendous contributions to world economy by focusing on its own development and achieving national progress and stability. The new philosophy of innovative, coordinated, green, open, and shared development proposed by the Chinese president not only points out the direction of sustainable economic growth for China itself, but also offers China's plan and wisdom for the reform, development, and stability of the world economy. Third, we should actively promote innovations in global governance and lead new progress on economic globalization. As global trade is growing at a slow pace, all countries should coordinate and cooperate more closely to promote fairness and justice, prevent trade protectionism, and make economic globalization more vigorous, inclusive, universally beneficial, and sustainable. Trade policies should boost innovation and digital economic development by formulating new rules in areas like e-commerce, facilitate the establishment of an inclusive global value chain, and help SMEs and the least developed countries to merge into the chain, and help with poverty elimination so as to achieve the 2030 SDG initiated by the UN. China has always been a firm proponent of the multilateral trading regime. Since it joined the WTO 15 years ago, China has strictly observed WTO's rules, earnestly fulfilled its commitments and obligations, and played an active and constructive role in the multilateral trade negotiations. It will continue to fully play its leading part as a responsible trading power, make positive contributions to WTO's continuous progress, protect the multilateral trading mechanism, and make global trade and investment more free and convenient. Building an open world economy requires us to promote innovations in the global governance structure. The 2016 G20 summit held in China's Hangzhou set up a trade and investment working group for the first time, which worked out the G20 strategy for global trade growth and G20 guiding principles for global investment policy. International organizations, including WTO, strongly endorsed the Hangzhou summit and the formulation of relevant policies. In May and June 2016, the B20 and T20 meetings were convened at the WTO headquarters to put the result of the G20 Hangzhou summit into practice depends on the united efforts of all parties. Fourth, we should intensify innovation and cooperation and contribute to building a human community of shared destiny. Throughout the human history, innovation is always a vital force that pushes the human society forward. Today, a new round of technological and industrial revolution is on the rise, which will bring both opportunities and challenges for global economic growth, international trade and investment, global value chain, industrial structure, global division of labor, labor force, and social security. While embracing the opportunities, we should follow the trade, work together more closely in such aspects as technology, finance, standardization, business environment, cybersecurity, and a new type infrastructure construction, and share in the fruits borne by technological progress and industrial development. While dealing with challenges, we should live up to our responsibilities, provide the necessary public services for medium-sized, small, and micro enterprises, laborers with mediocre or low skills and disadvantaged social groups. To implement the strategy of driving development with innovation, China placed equal importance on the twin engine of technological innovation and institutional innovation and rolled out a string of reform measures. In 2016, China puts in place the fair competition inspection system, innovated in the way of resource allocation, and intensified the protection of private property rights and IPR. It also set up a batch of innovation carriers, including National Independent Innovation Demonstration Zone, Technological Innovation Center, and Mass Entrepreneurship and Innovation Demonstration Base. Switzerland stands in a leading position in the world in its innovation capacity. Innovation cooperation between China and Switzerland will be highly complementary to both countries. It is of great significance for the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences and International Center for the Trade and Sustainable Development to co-host the Innovation and Development International Symposium. I look forward to the high-level dialogues, and I wish this symposium a complete success. Thank you very much. Thank you very much for your keynote speech.
This presentation, his keynote speech presents a comprehensive and in-depth picture concerning the development of Chinese economy. He figures out and expounds the new dynamics, problems, countermeasures, and the prospects of Chinese economy. He also gives stress on the fundamental ideas concerning the new paradigm of development in China. We also appreciate very much he highlights the significant role of the multilateral trading system in the development of the world. So from his speech, we are more confident that the development of China will benefit the world, and a more open global system of trade and investment will also benefit the growth of China. From his keynote speech, we can recognize a number of subjects of great importance for which we can conduct our further discussion during this seminar. So thank you very much for the very in-depth keynote speech by His Excellency Mr. Jiang Jianguo. So now I would like to announce the ending of this first session of this seminar. After a coffee break, we will continue the seminar to have further discussion and dialogue. Thank you very much for your presence.
We have a fabulous panel today. All of them are very well known in the community. I will introduce each of them when they speak. And you have more details of their short bio in front of you. The objective of this session is to come up with some creative ideas to address the big challenges the world is faced with. As the opening session has highlighted, they come from various directions, i.e. geopolitics, anti-globalization, market fragmentation risks, environmental degradation, disruptive technologies, or disruptive policies in some areas. My name is Wallace Shuaihuachan. I work as a managing director for ICTS China under Global Economic Governance Initiative. Normally, we have two criteria to select a moderator for important sessions. One is good looking. The other is good time management. So because I failed the first one, I tried to manage time well. What we are going to do is to invite each expert to speak for up to 10 minutes. So that we have a good time for Q&A. I will give a warning when only 1 minute left, then I will interrupt and stop at 10 minutes sharp. I'd like to start with Dr. Zhang Yuyan. Professor Zhang is a senior fellow and director general of the Institute of World Economics and Politics at CAS. He's our partner of this event. Professor Zhang has been well known as a leader, one of the leaders of think tank activity, think tank 20 activities during the last year when China is a G20 presidency. So Professor Zhang, you have the floor.
Thank you, moderator. It is a great honor, and I'm also quite pleased to attend this seminar. Innovation and development is an important issue for the current world. At the G20 Hangzhou Summit, which just concluded, as the presidency of G20, China, in terms of designing the agenda items for this summit, innovation was regarded as a very important element for the present world. The world economy has entered a transformational period. Since the breakout of the economic crisis, various governments have been trying to use short-term currency policies to recover their economies. However, what we have seen is the fact that the world economic recovery remains sluggish. Over the past few years, the economic development has maintained the growth rate of about 3%, behind which there are many reasons. And the most important factor seems to be that short-term policies fall short of addressing long-term economic issues. Long-term development and growth has innovation as its key. As we all know, economic development has three main driving forces. The first aspect is capital investment. Number two is labor force in terms of its quantity and quality. Third is all factor productivity, TFP, total factor productivity. Capital investment is closely linked to technological advancements. China, as Mr. Zhang in his opening remarks mentioned, is paying a great deal of attention to the research and development input. Our R&D accounts for over 2% of GDP. According to China's future plans, by 2020, China, in terms of R&D input, will have increased to 2.5% of our GDP. And this indicates that the Chinese government still hopes that in terms of capital investment and in particular technological advancements can increase its input so that the manufacturing productivity can be enhanced. In terms of labor input, the entire labor force of China in the future is actually entering the stage of slowing down and the reduction. According to Chinese economists, from 2010 to 2020, the supply of labor force in China will be decreased by 30 million to 35 million. Now, how to promote long-term economic development with a reduction of labor force in China remains a big question for China, and this is also a problem faced by many large economies. And our approach is still to improve labor market, promote competitiveness, and to reduce the impediments for the free flow of labor force. With regard to TFP, total factor productivity, is the result of technological advancements and remains a very critical factor for long-term development. In terms of TFP, I believe the in-depth issue remains competitiveness, competition. we need to increase competition, to increase innovation, relax the control by the governments, and reduce the barriers for entering into markets, protection of intellectual property, and respect for enterprises. Of course, this is only on the domestic level. On the international level, international trade and investment is also closely related. Our present world is faced with various challenges, among which trade and protectionism is one of them, and it is re-emerging. Perhaps using the word of re-emerging is no longer sufficient to describe it. The protectionism is on the severe rise. China bears the brunt of such protectionism. We have already listened to many discussions on the topic. With the new administration of the United States, China is due to face several rounds of difficulties, such as trade and development. For example, the taxation laid upon China's products, which might be over 40%, and also declaring China as a foreign exchange controlling country. And also, for example, NAFTA would have to enter into a new round of negotiations, and TPPs. 12 countries have already signed up to TPP agreements. However, we foresee that TPP agreements will also be encountered with difficulties. And this serious round of difficulties will not be only limited to China, but also other countries. Therefore, to encourage innovation and encourage investment, we must overcome these difficulties. Of course, many issues, if we think more deeply, can be understood well. Globalization has brought about many benefits to us. In particular, many countries may create more gain from trade due to globalization. On the other hand, globalization has also enabled many countries and people to be the winners of this process. On the other hand, it also has the benefit of income distribution. With income distribution, it enables many people and countries to become losers as well. Therefore, many people have blamed unemployment and loss of income upon globalization. We can understand their mindsets. However, this simple equation has a problem behind it. Globalization per se is necessary for all countries in the world. Globalization can bring benefits, as I mentioned. However, what we must pay particular attention to is to how to seek a certain level of balance between winners and losers arising from globalization, in particular using a certain level of domestic policies to create the effect of manufacturing and income. Globalization, in my opinion, mainly refers to the rising levels of interdependence among different countries and regions. Over the last 2 to 3 decades, globalization has experienced a fast development stage. However, the road of globalization is not always a plain sailing. Amongst this journey, we would not only be able to see flowers, but also difficulties. And now globalization has entered a long and winding road. It has presented many issues which would require joint efforts to overcome the various problems and conundrums and challenges we're faced with. President Xi Jinping will attend the Davos World Economic Forum shortly, and I believe at the forum he is due to deliver a message that is to say that China stands ready to work with all other countries in the world to promote globalization to a new stage so that globalization's fruits and the benefits brought about by globalization can be shared by more people. I thank you.
For the excellent talk. Now I would like to invite Dr. Harsha V. Singh. Dr. Singh is Executive Director of Brookings India, has been Deputy Director General for 8 years of WTO, where we are, and we're honored to have him as one of my colleagues at ICTSD for a few years. And he also held senior positions in Indian governments, companies, also teaches in various prestigious academic institutions. Dr. Singh, the floor is yours.
Thank you, Shuaiwa, and thanks to the organizers. I will focus on policy and institutional innovation. Since the topic is evolution of global trade and investment cooperation, I want to work with the backdrop of the fact that cooperation actually takes place through a spectrum of agreements ranging from soft to hard in terms of legal obligations. WTO, APEC, TPP, these are examples of the range of these kind of agreements. In this framework, I would like to you to consider government-to-government and government-to-business forms of cooperation to move positively global trade and investment cooperation. For this, we need to identify key areas of focus and concern. Presently, concerns more commonly considered by policymakers relate to protecting domestic employment and incomes, generating competitiveness of domestic enterprise through industrial policy, facilitating investment, acquisition of technology, including through local content, seeking more market access abroad, addressing adverse effects of NTMs in foreign markets, big data and privacy issues, and also policies which adversely affect the level playing field in international trade, for example, in areas of currency, weak IPRs, and different social and sustainable development standards. Quite a long list, this. Innovative solutions would therefore be required to provide flexibilities to reduce tariffs at an agreed comfortable pace, because countries today are not keen to open their markets. Facilitation through a common framework of as many trade-related segments as feasible, be it services, investment, competition policy. New disciplines for those policies which are presently widely used, contrary to accepted trade disciplines, and I'll share some thought on this. What I have in mind is local content. Develop new types of disciplines that address the fact that existing market conditions are evolving with the emergence of new prominent players and erosion of the base of some existing ones. The difficulty faced in concluding EGA is a case in point, where people are concerned that the critical mass may change over time. Establish mechanisms that would help informal initiatives, such as private standards, which proliferate, by adding disciplines applicable to them. Though the viewpoints regarding trade and investment in the world today are very different from even 2 years ago, some existing solutions can be applied to this new situation, and some new ones need to be devised to stimulate global trade and investment cooperation. Existing agreements themselves provide a good basis. Some of the agreements, whether bilateral or otherwise, address the same issue in different ways, and therefore show a way forward towards a common landing zone. I take the example of some innovative thinking, different way of looking at solutions, for instance, for tariff reduction, which must include both substantive opening up and inbuilt comfort factors. could include, for example, long transition periods, like in the TPP, much longer than those normally accepted in WTO. Focus sequentially on a limited part of the product categories under consideration. Say, suppose you are considering 100 products, take 25 to begin with, as the first tranche to be liberalized, something like a liberalized MFA kind of, though only 10 years, but different products to be liberalized at different types. Possibility of safeguards being used when import surges take place, and the process of market opening be stopped for a specified period. This specified safeguard period may be increased further, making presentation to the relevant committee. I am combining elements of WTO Safeguards Agreement Article 8.3 and WTO Subsidies Agreement Article 27.4. The tariff reduction be phase-wise. Second phase-wise may consider the next quarter of the relevant product category, say after 5 years, and so on sequentially. The extent of product coverage may vary for countries with different income levels or trade significance. For instance, 90% of products may be sequentially covered over a period of 20 or 30 years for top 20 or 30 trading economies. The next 20 trading economies may open up only about 50%. The rest may participate only on a voluntary basis, similar to a telecom reference paper kind of framework. The products for each country may be selected on the basis of significance of those products for each country in terms of that country's global export share. The idea of export competitiveness, which is in WTO Subsidies Agreement 27.6. Obviously, the significance of the product exported by a country concerned drops below a threshold level. This is not there in the WTO. You take more disciplines, but you don't take less disciplines. So, threshold level for export competitiveness for a specified number of years, either tariff reduction may be stopped for that product by the country concerned, or more flexible safeguard measures be allowed for that product with import surges. Along similar lines, if there is a plurilateral agreement with MFN, the provisions could include the possibility of safeguards akin to quota modulation in the WTO Safeguards Agreement, Article 5.2b, with greater focus on the quotas applicable to the new large exporter of the product when the whole situation changes in the market for critical mass. These ideas clearly show a need to revisit the WTO Safeguard Agreement also. Once you have agreement in this, the agreement on safeguard is a consequential change. A similar combination of disciplines and flexibilities could be agreed for IPRs as well. My friend here will, I'm sure, talk more about that. This could be managed by combining approaches with concentric circles of variation in disciplines, or in terms of time period allowed for higher disciplines combined with the concept of benefit sharing. We do have compulsory licensing. I want to propose the concept of benefit sharing with IPRs as well, which is now increasingly in vogue in the area of FDI or through the concept of corporate social responsibility. There may be a period of initial implementation of the agreement with a review based on experience. Likewise, an approach with concentric circles of agreed disciplines may be used for different areas covered for providing trade facilitation, services, investment, etc. Most countries facilitate investment today or services in order to get competitive advantage or to acquire new technologies. An approach which combines elements of the present trade facilitation agreement and the telecom reference paper could be used in the format of concentric circles. Some widely used policies may be accepted for discipline by all concerned above a particular income level, something like Annex 7 of WTO Subsidies Agreement, carving out those who don't agree. Other facilitation policies may be considered with relevant disciplines to be adopted by a voluntary basis, not just by low economies, but even the middle income economies. There are certain policies like local content which are being widely used, and they are inconsistent in general, other than government procurement, with present WTO disciplines. For innovation, for developing countries, this is especially important because innovation in developing countries is incremental. It doesn't move the frontier the way often innovation in developed countries does. In developing countries, it's an incremental process. So the widespread use of local content perhaps shows a need to reconsider the existing disciplines. It won't be the first time. This was done, for example, during the Uruguay round when VERs were to be addressed by making safeguards more easy to use. One possible way is to consider not a prohibition for local content, but adverse effect or injury the way Article 6 of WTO subsidies agreement considers certain situations of serious prejudice. So if you are hurt by an action in WTO, you actually complain. If you are not hurt, what is the problem? That is the attitude I would like to introduce in this context, especially if so many of us are using it. With respect to regulatory cooperation or to address, and regulatory cooperation is crucial to really deal with non-tariff measures, or to address concerns that arise regarding the NTMs in export markets, cooperative solutions are contained in TPP. It may be considered as already dead, but it has a lot of very useful organs which can be transplanted. And that can be a good basis to take this issue forward. Such cooperative solutions would also be required to address certain likely situations arising due to innovation and technological change, which are completely going to change the paradigm of trade relations. And these issues are not as much occupying trade policy makers today as it should. Because you prepare a meal and the whole menu has changed. I'll give you some example. And softer cooperative agreements will be necessary for them to extend common yet effective juridical reach of each member. For example, to address the combined impact of trade on trade of digital platform, 3D printing, and M2M communication. Where is the product made? Who's making it? Who are you going to control? This would blur the ability of governments to control or even identify the source of value added in trade, or even maintain meaningful FTAs. What does it mean that you are a member of FTA and M2M communication and 3D printing is combining parts which you cannot identify, isolate, and say, hey, this was not the content of this FTA. The whole FTA content provisions will be completely destroyed through these new technologies. Certain other trade policy engagement are very important because from formal, these trade policy engagements are shifting to informal arrangements. Private standards are only an example. I don't want to, given Shuaihua's strict rule, and I just will take one more minute. I don't want to go into other detail, but if you try and see what's happening in global trade relations today, we are shifting from formal to informal. What is the president-elect statement to a company saying, I will impose a tariff of X percent if it is not informal? And this is only one example which will ring through. There are several others, including every major economy in world trade. With expanding scope of trade policies and informalization of several trade policies, there is a need to consider possibility of, very quickly, agreement to discipline in terms of different modes of supply for goods. So if we can have four modes where if there is investment in services, it's mode three. Is there not investment in goods? Why should you not treat it in a similar manner? ICTSD has done detailed work on this thing. So we should actually try and have consistency. That's an innovation. And it will also open up the door for moving ahead in a piecemeal process. A framework of disciplines for informal initiatives like private standards or even a serious threat of market restrictive action. We need to think about that. A platform, the German government has come up with some kind of initiative on the first one, which is discipline of private standards. A platform with lead firms in global value chains, SMEs, and regional development bank. And this is where you cannot have a world which is growing, leaving behind a large part of the world which does not get enabled to participate effectively in it. So you need a platform where the lead firms and SMEs actually engage in the presence of regional development banks And whatever training or policies, et cetera, come up, they are taken up together in a cooperative, collaborative manner. For wider implementation of the potential link with GVCs. The platform would also train regulators. Can you imagine how technology is changing? Where, okay, there's 0 minute left. Where I come from, zero is the most important number. So may I take 0.5 minutes? This platform would also train regulators and produce collaborative solutions. We have to anticipate what technology will do in terms of bypass, ability of regulators to regulate. So that's something which, and the private sector is best placed to advise on that. Identify key areas of disagreement, I would suggest, and have panel of experts or think tanks to suggest practical, innovative solutions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Hasha, for the brilliant intervention. The both speakers have been given very inspiring, many inspiring ideas, and also both are quite disciplined, I would say. Finished around 10 minutes and 30 seconds. That is a good example. Now I would like to invite Dr. Zhang Xiaojing. Dr. Zhang is a professor of economics at CAS. He has actively participated in China's five-year plan consultation work for the last 15 years, basically 3 5-year plans. But also, if you have questions about how much debt China has, he is also the right person to ask, because he is in charge of the Center for National Balance Sheet that releases China's assets and liabilities data publicly and regularly. So now I would like to invite Dr. Zhang to give his presentation.
Thank you, Chair. I'm very honored to be here to share my view about China's economy. Now please allow me to speak in Chinese. Sorry.
我今 Today, my topic is about Chinese economy in the new normal. If we combine this topic with our today's thematic debate, it indicates that only through structural reform will we actually maintain long-term sustainable growth. At the outset, I would like to talk about Chinese economy in the new normal. Actually, during the minister's Mr. Zhang's statement, he also mentioned new normal. The first element of the new normal is structural optimization. In the past, we mainly relied on investment and export to drive growth. And today, this element has become consumption. Our consumption is over 50, even 60% for growth. Consumption contribution towards growth this year has reached 70%. And second is industries. In the past, we rely on manufacturing services and manufacturing sectors. However, this year we mainly rely on the service industry. And the third element is innovation. Nowadays, in terms of innovation, China is making every effort, and certain achievements have been made. I would like to, in this regard, set some examples for you. First is the R&D input. The European Commission has a list of, has a survey of 2,500 investment companies. Among top 100, China, in mainland China, there are six, and Huawei ranked number eight. And secondly, there are patent-intensive industries and emerging industries, and these industries actually grow much faster than normal industries, reaching double digits. And thirdly, what we cannot ignore is that entering the new normal stage, China's economic development is actually slowing down. How to address this issue? I believe it is indeed because of the structural issues within China that have resulted in the slowdown in China's economic development. The international financial crisis, of course, has had a negative impact on China's economic development. However, structural issues are more fundamental. I would like to mention the Central Economic Work Conference that has just been concluded. It reiterated that our contradiction problems, although have cyclical and quantitative factors, but the root cause is the structural imbalance. In order to address these structural issues, Mr. Zhang also mentioned that these issues include the demographic changes and resource constraints, and these factors can become long-term impediments to our development. Therefore, not only China, but also the entire globe, only by structural adjustment and institutional innovation will we come out of the crisis and will we be able to maintain a decent growth. And hereby, I would like to reiterate that after the financial crisis, at the global level, many countries have had various different types of stimulus, and the result of which has not been so ideal. Of course, in terms of the US economic development, it has recovered steadily. However, at the global level, because of the expansion of the stimulus packages, the leveraging ratio has increased significantly. From 2007 to 2015, the leveraging has increased by $57 trillion, and in terms of percentage, it is 17% increase. This is a very fast level. And the second phenomenon we have seen is the asset bubble, not only the property market, but also the gold market and other markets. We have all witnessed the risks of asset bubbles. And this is the result of investment policies only, as China has witnessed similar cases. Of course, the moderator also introduced that I am in charge of balance sheets in China. I would like to introduce China's expansion of stimulus packages have also brought with it many risks which we cannot avoid. For instance, China's leveraging ratios has also increased over the last two decades. The increase has been from $10 billion to 23 billion RMBs. Which constitutes 2.5 times of the GDP. This is a very high leveraging ratio. And these expansion packages have also brought about bubble crises, such as the real estate bubble. The international community pays great attention to China's debt crisis and debt crisis. And the statistics I have given to you also indicate such level of risks. But how big is the risk? Because of China's structural structures are quite different from the other countries. Therefore, in addressing debt crisis, we still have a lot of room to play with. Here is the very simple comparison. This arrow points to China's net asset of the government in terms of the total assets in China, accounting for 23.8%, nearly a quarter. This is very high in terms of the globe. In the US or the UK, their ratio is negative. However, in China, net governmental assets account for nearly a quarter. Of course, in some countries, it's less than 1%. Therefore, with the resources at hand in China, China is fully capable of addressing debt crisis. At the end of last century, China also had similar crises. In terms of including Goldman Sachs, many companies were believed to actually go bankrupt. Therefore, at present, I'm also quite confident that China will be fully capable of addressing the debt crisis. Lastly, I would like to say that only by structural innovation, only by seizing the opportunity of incentives will we be able to come out of the crisis? Actually, the actual growth in 2016 was better than the expectations and forecasts. Many countries expected that China would not grow so much in 2016. However, the actual growth rate was 6.7%. Why? Because we have had many appropriate policies, including policies from the government. Therefore, if we lack the endogenous vitality within the market, we will actually be in difficulties. Only when we give enough level of incentives and motivation to the market will we actually maintain a certain level of growth. And I would like to talk about four areas that we can actually redress our incentive policies. The first is we need to address local competition. Over the last three decades, through local competition, we have seen some achievements. However, the risks that brought with it were the debt crisis and other problems. But shall we have a one-size-fits-all policy? I believe over the last three decades, we have been focusing on our GDP increase, and at present, we must focus our efforts on providing good levels of public services. And hereby, we also have a challenge. When we compete with other countries' GDP, it's a top-down policy. However, providing public services is the other way around. How can we actually provide a level of limitations and control of the local government whilst also maintaining a certain level of flexibility remains a task for us? And of course, as we all know, we have actually had some certain level of cracking down and anti-corruption policies. However, if local governments are too scared of stirring up problems or troubles, then there will be difficulties as well. The Central Working Group meeting also indicated that with regard to the local governments, not only we should have anti-corruption policies, but also should have some encouragement for them. Mr. Zhang also mentioned these policies. Okay, well, it seems that I have run out of time. Maybe I have 0.5 minute. Secondly, we need to protect property rights, not only public but also private properties, not just intangible but also tangible assets. Also, we need to motivate entrepreneurship. Lastly, it is quite closely related to our theme today, we need to actively attract foreign direct investment. Maybe for some period of time, we have loosened our sight on foreign direct investment. We need to refocus our efforts on FDIs and improve the environment for business so that they can carry out their business more properly. Thank you.
Sure, Dr. Zhang. So you have noticed that China and India, they like to have extra 0.5. I hope that brings good hope for the global growth. Now I would like to invite a representative from UNCTAD because Shamik is not feeling very well this morning, but he kindly sent Mr. Anja González Sanz. Anja is Chief of Science, Technology and ICT branch in UNCTAD. Because we do not have his full bio available, maybe Anja, you can give your maybe a brief self-introduction to us before your formal presentation. The floor is yours. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Cheng, and thank you very much to ICTSD and the Chinese Academy of Sciences for inviting Anja to be present in this very interesting debate this morning. Just one word about myself. I am an economist, and I have been for longer than I care to remember working in UNCTAD on issues of technology and innovation, originally in ICT and now in a broader setting. I'm leading the team that is working on the Technology and Innovation Report, the e-commerce initiatives, the information economy report, the policy, science and technology policy reviews. So our focus is obviously on the impact of technology and innovation on the development prospects of the world economy. And we're also the Secretariat of the UN Commission on Science and Technology for Development. As the moderator said, originally the intention was to have a presentation today by my director, Sami Keshirimanis, is unfortunately unable to come this morning, but I will be following her notes for tomorrow, for today. I don't have a PowerPoint, thankfully. The new International Development Agenda, the SDGs, was built on a vision of an increasingly integrated global community. Unfortunately, it seems that at least its first years of implementation are going to be taking place in a context where this vision of an increasingly integrated community is turning out to be more and more difficult to realize. The interaction between international trade, investment, and technology changes have a lot to do with the situation in which the advocates for an open trade and investment agenda are starting to be under siege. Advancing a liberal trade agenda in developed countries is becoming increasingly politically difficult. In the developing world, fears of the disruptive effects of a globalized economy on inequality and in jobs are putting pressure on decision makers too. Yet, we know that boosting productive capacity through investment and technology and building better regional and global trade links are vital ingredients for the long-term reduction of poverty. Open trade and investment, together with technological advance and deepening knowledge, have lifted billions out of poverty over the last three decades. It is our common responsibility to ensure that this process is sustained. To blame trade for job losses is to use a convenient scapegoat, but it ignores both the benefits of trade and the disruptive potential of technology. Trade does not explain the relative loss of labor productivity that many developed countries have suffered. Trade and investment cannot account for the erosion of social protection that are the results of specific political agendas. However, the rise of populist movements, the escapism towards the misplaced hope that protectionism can actually work in the benefit of workers, cannot be ignored. The perceived and the real losses that have been suffered by many categories of workers in the developed world, but also in some developing countries, are to be blamed to the process of economic financialization that has been accompanied by an increasingly biased income distribution. Insecurities may also come from perceptions of the loss of cultural identities or of political control. In other words, what amounts to an unilateral change in the social contract. Advocates of trade and technology-driven globalization, including ANTAD and other international organizations, have not paid nearly enough attention to these concerns compared to the material benefits that greater trade and investment have brought to the world community. This has undermined our credibility and, in the end, the political and intellectual legitimacy of our undertaking. So we really need to take this issue seriously. A healthy global economy requires trust and rule-based governance, including in trade, investment, and technology, in which countries can work together for their mutual benefits. Nobody ever benefited from greater isolationism, and this is particularly true in the case of innovation. Trade and foreign direct investment have been significant drivers of technological learning for some developing countries. However, we observe that the technological benefits from trade and investment do not happen automatically. For instance, in the case of least developed countries, ANTAD research has found time and time again that there's very little evidence of a significant contribution from foreign investment to technological capability accumulation. And this is largely due to the nature of the relationships that exist between foreign investors and the host country economy. also the policy priorities of the governments themselves and the generally very low absorptive capabilities that exist in these economies. Beyond the LDCs, evidence and our own experience also indicate that increasing openness to trade and investment are not necessarily supporting the building of domestic technological capabilities in general. On the one hand, many countries that have pursued open policies to trade and investment and have benefited from access to capital and employment opportunities have seen limited impact of those in the building of domestic technological capabilities. On the other hand, FDI can and does contribute to employment creation, to capital formation, and occasionally to the diversification of production. Countries that have remained relatively close to globalization face even more significant challenges in translating any technological capabilities into tangible growth. So the solution is not to become closer. The solution is to build capabilities. What can you do to that? Some TNCs, transnational corporations, can offer technology transfer opportunities to their subsidiaries. But in the lack of, or in the absence of well-defined, sustained, and coherently implemented STI policies from the host country, and this usually translates in a coherent national system of innovation, the development of capability does not happen. Economic policies are often focused more on trade and on maintaining balances, both in the accounts of payments and also in the overall macroeconomic scenario, and not so much on promoting technological learning. When public procurement policies do not include local sourcing requirements, support for promoting local technological capabilities is inevitably weak. A failure in policy to stimulate economy-wide technological upgrading increases the risk of falling into the middle-income trap that many developing countries are now facing. Policy coherence and coordination is perhaps the biggest challenge for developing countries, which is at the same time under the purview and control of policymakers. Policy coherence is required at many different levels, including between STI policy, FDI policy, and trade policy, but also among sectoral policies and among policies that aim to provide the fundamental human, financial, and physical infrastructures that are needed for a functional and open economy. Policy coherence and coordination also have a vertical component. How does policy that aims at grassroots development, entrepreneurship development, and SME growth, and policies targeting the youth and startups, how do they mesh with overall national economic policy? Are there mechanisms such as national systems of innovation that work to ensure that science and technology policies are actually relevant for the industrial needs of the country? National experiences suggest that international trade and investment flows and their accompanying policies are necessary, but insufficient for development. Strong policies are critical in the areas of governance of the innovation system. And we have the example of countries from Finland to Singapore to Korea that show how aiming to develop technological capabilities and absorptive capacities is critical. Our own national policy reviews that we conduct in UNCTAD from Peru to Rwanda have noted the lack of coherent policies and the need for national systems of innovation frameworks that encourage, facilitate, and oversee the crafting and implementation of coherent innovation-driven economic development policies. Coherent policies also require access to national and international information. They must be evidence-based and be revised in accordance with incoming data and performance indicators. Information need to go beyond what is the generally available economic data and refer also to the surveillance or the analysis of local capabilities, including the impact of trade, investment, and other policies on the development of the capacities of firms to actually engage in technological learning. It's now 0 minutes, so I will just want to emphasize that from our perspective, this willingness from the political dimension to take control of the development of technological capabilities at the local level is essential for any benefits of international trade to actually materialize. And from the international side, there is a responsibility to ensure that rules of trade and to the extent that they are relevant intellectual property or other aspects are supportive of these national efforts to encourage technological learning. Without a domestic driven effort for technological learning, nothing can happen. Thank you very much.
Great. Ankita also get extra 0.5. That's great. Speed up. Thank you for the excellent intervention, and you bring experience from technology cooperation and particularly from development perspective. I think that is very helpful. Now I would like to invite Mr. Anthony Toberman. Mr. Toberman is currently director for international intellectual property division of the WTO, with responsibility for WTO's programs on intellectual property, competition policy, and government procurement. He was also director at WIPO. Prior to that, he had worked for Australian Department of Foreign Affairs and Trade, and also has held teaching positions in leading universities. The floor is yours, Mr. Toberman.
Thank you. Thank you very much indeed, and thank you very quickly to the organisers for the invitation to take part in this stimulating exchange. I am not being very innovative in my PowerPoint presentation, but given that the good looks of the moderator eclipse me, I need to create a diversion. And I recall that the concept of zero as a number was invented, in fact, in India. So if I have struggle with the notion of zero, I'll have to defer to my colleague, Harsha. We do have limited time, and so I will be speaking in generalities. But what we have before us is a very important forward agenda for us in the WTO, but also for the multilateral system as such, because the questions we're wrestling with, I've been touched on already, are the questions that very sceptical questions are being posed of what these institutions are doing, why we're doing it, and what its impact is on communities. So we do need to dig deeply into these issues. At the same time, we have to accept that if we're looking at a trade and innovation agenda and its implications for achieving the SDGs, we have to understand and accept that these are inherently complex ideas. They're irreducibly diverse in character, both trade, what trade is, development, our aspirations for development, and indeed what innovation looks like. One of the difficulties we have in discussing the TRIPS agreement in this context is that in its 20 years of life, it's often been identified or even stigmatized as one innovation model in a binary way, i.e. you can have that model or something else. And I think that misses the point. It's one ingredient, it's one element of a much more diverse, multifactorial innovation ecosystem. So we have the challenge of understanding that complexity and diversity, at the same time working internationally in a way that is holistic, that is realistic and inclusive in the global context. How can we do that? Well, firstly, we can do that by basing our work on an empirical foundation of actual experience. And I'll develop this. So in talking about TRIPS and innovation, less about what we could call the bound regime, what the rules say, what TRIPS says as an agreement, or what it should say, or what it could be rewritten to say, and more on what you could call the applied regime of TRIPS, how 164 members have worked in very, very diverse ways within that framework to progress innovation policy and innovation goals. That's the foundation. And at the international level, due to the diversity and the complexity of the matter, ultimately we can only talk about broad principles, international principles, rather than policy prescriptions that would apply to all our members. And look more, and I see TRIPS in this context, look more at the interoperability of national systems and the way rules enable that, interoperability of innovation systems, rather than providing a specific, again, models or prescriptions for innovation capacity. And one of those principles is indeed the one of benefit sharing that Harsha has mentioned. And I will mention, I will suggest that it is embedded actually in the principles of the TRIPS agreement. We do need to work with different conceptions of innovation, whether it's a lone genius innovating, the traditional concept, or innovation, as we're increasingly understanding, as a collaborative, interactive exercise, a networking process, whether it's Apollo projects or whether it's developing innovation based on traditional knowledge, irreducibly complex, as is the concept of development. Development conventionally or traditionally seen in terms of infrastructure development, still critically important for many developing countries, and as we hear, developed countries as well, confronting infrastructure challenges. Is it about providing the tools for development to occur? Or is it about equipping the neurons, equipping knowledge, if you like, uploading know-how into the workforce, into the potential research community? Well, of course, it's all of these, and we can't necessarily favour or privilege one or look at them in isolation. This is the challenge of having a holistic approach, which is at the same time realistic and empirically founded. The challenge becomes all the more demanding if we look at the ambition, the range, the depth of the Sustainable Development Goals, which certainly do define, shape multilateral work in the field of sustainable development. That's their very purpose. And it's interesting to see how innovation is laced through the SDGs in different ways. And part of that question is how trade agreements and trade can be cast as part of the innovation ecosystem. whether we look at, from one end of the telescope, trade-related innovation, the way that innovation may be a tool for achieving the policy goals of trade, or whether it's about innovation-related trade, the way that trade itself can support innovation goals. Impossible to privilege one of these perspectives over the other. We need to take a holistic view. And this holistic view is, in my view, what needs to underpin the design of trade agreements, the kind of ideas, indeed, that Harsha has been exploring. But looking at innovation within the SDGs, one of the innovations, indeed, within the SDGs compared to the MDGs is adding innovation as such, as an object in itself. Innovation is a sustainable development goal, is a goal in itself. This is a very interesting frame shift. For me, innovation has always been in the background as a tool, as the way we achieve development goals. But now we have it working at both levels, both as an object in itself and as a mechanism, because it's inconceivable to imagine achieving the ambitious SDG goals on food, on climate, on health, on energy, sanitation, environmental protection, if we were to be limited to the technologies that happen to exist, the toolkit that we had in place when the SDGs were drawn up or concluded in 2015. Clearly not. Innovation is part of delivering on the SDGs, and you'll see this right through the SDG mechanism. Equally, innovative technologies will be required to support the institution building and the development, the implementation of partnerships that are identified, SDGs 16 and 17. This will require innovation in itself, as well as in the monitoring of the achievement of SDGs. So innovation is laced right through the SDGs. The question is, how can we use our existing tools, our existing framework, effectively to achieve this? Turning then parochially to our own agreement, the TRIPS agreement. In the past, at a similar event, I explored the question of whether the TRIPS agreement, if you like, is up to the tasks put before it now, given that it was drawn up as you might say, in an analog era. It was drawn up before we had a real understanding of what digital trade would look like. Is it indeed an analog treaty in a digital age? Not quite ready for the challenges of the digital environment, the new innovative ways that people are trading today? Or is it providentially the first trade 2.0 agreement, the first multilateral trade agreement that recognises that you can have invaluable trading transactions that do not involve traditional goods and services? That's the question before us. It's obviously that the question that arises in the current discussions about electronic commerce in the WTO today. Certainly, the app economy, the kind of digital trade that we see today was not foreseen by the negotiators of the TRIPS agreement. It was very much an idea that IP was embedded in traded goods. It had its roots in negotiations on counterfeit trade, counterfeit goods. But today we do have, in a number of important industry sectors, we see trade in IP as such, IP as a tradable good, intellectual property as a tradable good in itself. A really dramatic frame shift, not just in how we see IP, but how we see trade. Trade is the middle name of this organisation. What trade constitutes has been transformed in the last 20 years. And the question is, are our rules ready to, or can they be retrofitted with this new notion of trade and the way intellectual property fits into the trade agreement? When we got the TRIPS negotiators actually in this room to talk about their experience with the 20 years anniversary of TRIPS, that's one thing that they mentioned. No, we didn't see this coming. They did say that they saw the negotiation of TRIPS as essentially looking at intellectual property as an adjunct to trade in goods, rather than intellectual property as a tradable good in itself. Kathy Field's chapter in this book has a fascinating discussion along those lines. But they were aware of the policy goals, policy objectives of the intellectual property system. And indeed, the TRIPS agreement is the first multilateral agreement to articulate why we have an intellectual property system in the first place. This is Article 7, establishes very clearly, at least as an aspiration or an objective, a goal, if you like, that the IP system is about promotion of innovation. It's very much part of the policy context of the TRIPS agreement from the beginning, as well as the availability of the fruits of innovation, transfer and dissemination of technology. Fine. That's, in principle, that's excellent. Indeed, that captures three preceding centuries of the development of patent law and patent policy. It's always been the objective to promote innovation, but how to achieve that exactly? And this is why we need to pivot today from a discussion about the bound regime, the rules in Articles 7 and its the other articles, to the applied regime, how to make it work. And in the TRIPS agreement, we are seeing a very interesting set of discussions, not a set of negotiations, far from it, not a presaging a rewriting of the rules, but reports from a wide spectrum of our members on how they are working to achieve this in a whole host of areas connected with innovation. And to me, this is a very positive development in that we are starting to talk more and more about the applied regime, but in a policy context, understanding in a practical way how the how a wide range of policy options can be applied to achieve the social and economic welfare gains that the TRIPS Article 7 talks about in general terms. Similarly, for LDCs, naturally, importantly, a high priority for our cooperative work, a recognition in TRIPS that technology transfer is essential for the development of a sound and viable technological base, a recognition that LDCs have to be part of the innovation cycle, And we do have, while incomplete information, growing wealth of experience reported on how members have worked to promote incentives for technology transfer. And this is complemented by initiatives such as under the Istanbul Agenda for Action, the very recent establishment of a LDC technology bank, which I see as a very important adjunct and complement to this work. Because after all, if we are to achieve the SDGs, if we are to see the effective dissemination and adaptation uptake of, for example, clean technology, clean energy technologies, it's inherently complex. I won't begin to unpack this slide. Its very message is that it's complex. The task of establishing a viable, efficient wind farm as a foundation for clean technology, clean energy technology, does involve navigating a whole host of issues, the extent to which private and public incentive inputs are required, the degree of openness or exclusivity or leverage over technology that is required to package together the necessarily complex, intricate technology package that constitutes a delivered outcome in this area. So this creates a need for innovation in policy making and for innovation in the very governance structures. And I will conclude, I promise, at 0.1 on how we are trying to work to achieve this at a multilateral level. This is in an area highlighted necessarily in the SDGs, that of public health, an understanding that access and innovation to medicines is an indispensable part of achieving sustainable development. It's a high priority SDG, as well as a broader priority. The Doha Declaration on TRIPS and Public Health recalls that for us here in the WTO. And this has been an area of conscious innovation in governance, in international cooperation, in multilateral cooperation, with the three Directors General, WHO, WIPO and WTO, taking a personal role in forging a more collaborative, cooperative platform for our work, but also, I stress, involving many other players in the multilateral field, ranging from human rights to our colleagues in UNCTAD. And it's based on this idea that innovation and access in the area of medical technologies is the central goal, but it does involve understanding each of these policy areas, ranging from procurement policy to human rights, to competition policy, to conventional trade policy, tariffs, non-tariff barriers, and of course innovation policy and how you manage your patent system. All of these elements have to be understood and have to fit together for the optimal outcomes we're looking for. We can't isolate any one of these areas and worry away in it in isolation and expect to achieve SDG 3 in this area on public health. We have to look at it in that collaborative, coherent, holistic way. So to conclude, very quickly, promotion of innovation and access to the fruits of innovation do form part of an holistic innovation ecosystem. We do need to look at all of the moving parts together and not isolate or pin our hopes on any single policy domain. We're looking at a moving target. Of course, innovation necessarily changes the frame. It wouldn't be innovation if it didn't. Disruptive technologies do disrupt, and we've heard the concerns about the impact of that disruption. But equally, they open up new frontiers for access to global markets, and this is an important consideration for SMEs and producers in the missing words here, in developing countries. And certainly we cannot imagine the attainment of SDGs without innovation. We're looking for innovation in the technologies that will deliver clean technology, health, and global access to innovation, critical elements of the SDGs. But equally, innovation for us in the international systems, in the institutional and policy framework that shapes and supports global cooperation. And with that, I reach zero. Thank you.
Mr. Toberman, the 0.1 is very long. But thank you for the very informative presentation. Now I would like to invite our last panelist, Dr. Dong Yan. She is the head of Trade Department of CAS. The floor is yours, Dr. Dong.
Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. My presentation is about innovation and development in China's trade progress. Please allow me to give my presentation in Chinese. 那么今天呢，我想探讨的是中国如何通过。
Today, I would like to talk about how to use innovation and development to promote trade progress and some new concepts of development as well as their effects. After the financial crisis, the global economy has been sluggish. According to WTO's estimates, the growth is around 1.7%. If we take consideration of the
不增长,
other factors, the growth is in fact negative. In this context of slow growth of trade, in 2016 in China, according to the 10-month statistics, we have already achieved a recovering trend and a slow growth. The Chinese trade contribution to the stability of the global trade after the financial crisis is positive. In the meantime, because of the optimization of the trade structure and upgrade, we have used innovation to lift China out of the slowdown trends. If we're looking into the 10-month statistics in detail, we can easily see that the new modes have progressed very fast. In the 10th first year, the growth has been more than The private enterprises have also grown very fast. With regard to high-tech import and export, over the 10 months, the situation is quite sound. In the meantime, the products have been diversified so that we can keep up with the globalization and the changes in the global market. On the other hand, from the reform aspect, we have adopted a measure of building a new economic model, which puts the innovation in the focus. Some of the measures have already been rolled out positively. First of all, with regard to foreign investments, we have amended 4 laws regarding foreign investments. In particular, in 2016 October, we have changed a major rule, which changed from the approval system to case building system. From the 10 first months, we could see that the newly established foreign investment in enterprises in China reached 3% of increase, and the use of foreign capital amount, initially we estimated, according to our estimation, it was 113.79 billion, which is 3.9% year on year. We also changed some investment mode, such as merger and acquisitions, which has greatly improved. This has promoted us to the high end of the value chain. On the other hand of the reform, to adapt to the international standard and create a more transparent environment in China, we have created free trade zones in 4 areas in China. In the past years, their efforts have been put in investment, trade, finance, and customs service. They have already accumulated some experiences. In 2016, the pilot project has been extended from four areas to other new areas, such as in the north part of China. We have increased seven new pilot areas. Through this measure, we have extended the coverage of this measure to the entire China. The third aspect is the One Belt, One Road policy. And we have achieved a very remarkable achievements. And more importantly, this measure is quite different to other regional cooperation model because it includes an inclusive global value chain. And with One Belt, One Road policy, it can integrate better into the globalization and in particular global productivity. And it's an inclusive step. We have also made progress in GVCs. For example, in the Asia Pacific area, China is the main country or key country. And during the G20 Hangzhou summit and the APEC economic leaders meeting, we've proposed some detailed policy. We've also established a data center for the trading value added calculation. On top of that, we have also concrete measures to promote industrial fund support, trade and investment facilitation, finance and innovation. After these years of development, the reforms and the opening up have already promoted the market's development, and the opening is still steadily increasing. In manufacturing area, the competitive has been improving and upgrading towards the higher end of value chain. Through our own development in China, we proposed some new concepts to lead in the global trade growth. The Chinese concepts with regard to global trade growth the following. First, innovation should be the leading force. Some colleagues already mentioned that trade and innovation have many aspects. I think the first aspect would be the governance change, innovation of global trade governance. Second, trade policy to support innovative activities, for example, digital economy. The second part or aspect is inclusive development. Today, the global, the economic globalization is facing a great deal of debates. We have the view that it is still a major developing force for all countries. But we should also take into consideration of inclusiveness with regard to trade and development, trade and poverty alleviation and environment. These are the questions that we should pay more attention to. We should put in more new concepts in the trade system. The third aspect is multilateral trading system. In the past years, the regionalization of trade has the traditional form of liberalization of trade. In the meantime, it has also provided other profits, for example, providing a platform for the regional competition as well as a policy platform. In 2010, there's a reversing trend, which is also an adjustment of the trade globalization. It doesn't mean that it will stop. However, it means that global trade will still be a cornerstone of the global economy.
Now I'd like to open the floor for questions. Please identify yourself and be brief. Any questions? The gentleman, please.
Thank you very much. My name is Hector Torres. I come from the IMF. Well, there are many things I could say, but I will address only what Harsha said, not because I don't like the others, but because I was really impressed by some of your ideas. I heard two different Harshas, one the forward-looking Harsha at the new trade areas. You spoke about machine-to-machine, you spoke about 3D, and you rightly, in my view, questioned where are we going to be what are we going to be doing with FTAs and with local content, and we need innovation there, certainly institutional innovation. But then I also heard Harsha speaking about traditional trade areas, goods, and you proposed to modify the safeguard agreements to make it more flexible. You proposed to link tariffs in trade and goods to mode 3 investment in goods. And I have some doubts there. That more than innovation, it looks like a little bit of backtracking. And my question, Harsha, is this the time to try some innovation in traditional trade areas? Or is it a time to hold the ground of the international cooperation we have already achieved? Because I would assume, and please tell me if I'm wrong, that giving in some, I would say, room for protectionist policies would not appease the animal spirits of the nationalist and the populist. It would rather be encouraging them, allowing them to claim credit for a victory, and putting us further into a problem we want to precisely avoid. So is this a time to try institutional innovation in traditional trade areas, or is it a time to hold the ground, and how could we do that? Thank you.
Can I ask maybe to see if there's more questions? Just we have time for one round of questions, three or four questions, then we'll ask each panelist, particularly the targeted panelist, to answer. Yes, please.
Thank you. My name is Fleur Hayworth, and I work with Women at the Table, which is an NGO which co-founded International Gender Champions in Geneva. I have a question about gender. Given that Secretary Generals for the last few generations have identified gender equality as one of the key components of sustainable development, how do you see women in innovation, and what would you say also about the presentation of the panels this morning and women's role in that policy making, as well as the policy implications of innovation and trade? Thank you.
Do you have more questions? One, two, three. Okay, the last one. Yes, please.
Microphone. Okay. I come from, I'm a doctor from the HUID, and I have a question about Zhang Xiaojing. I'm very interested about the Gao Dui Ji Li, you know, the making the institutional system right. I think it's very important for the China's the future in development. You know, to convert the GDP competence to the public service competence. But you know, the GDP competence is there are number can account it, but there no number can count the public service the quality or the quantity. So I think that's quite that will be a question about this. So you have anything thought about this? Thank you.
Thank you very much. Now maybe I invite Harsha and Dr. Zhang to speak first, then from the Dr. Yan in this order.
Yeah.
Each one have 1 minute.
Yeah.
Is that okay?
Yeah. I will later.
Yeah, okay. From Dr. Dong, please. From that order, yes. Within 1 minute.
Okay. Thank you for your question. My point here is that when you measure the public service, we still have some indicators for that. So, for example, we want to measure, you know, the education, the health system, the environmental protection, for mm-hmm. example, the blue sky,
oh, yeah.
and also you know, the job creation, and also the poverty alleviation. And I think now the central government set up some kind of, you know, indicators for the public services in local governments. Mm-hmm. So I think if we can use such kind of indicator, we can measure, you know, this, you know, fundamentally or generally, I mean.
Mm-hmm.
But the you know, the key point here is that it's not just, you know, be judged by the central government. It should be judged by the, you know, the general republic, general public, you know. So that's most important. So we need the institutional reform, institutional innovation. And now it's just on the way. Yeah, thank you.
Thank you, Anha. Would you like to speak?
Just to pick up on the question about gender, I think it's a very, very important issue. If you want to achieve legitimacy in your innovation policies, you have to make them inclusive. And probably the gender dimension is the most relevant one if you want to achieve inclusiveness in innovation policy or in any other development policy for that matter, for many reasons. But if you want to pick just one, because probably by addressing gender concerns, you are also addressing the concerns of most of the poor people in the world, because that's where poverty concentrates, or women are much more poor as an average than men. So that's very important, and that connects to what has been picked up by several of the panelists about the importance of ensuring policy coherence. If you want to be successful in your innovation policy, you also have to be considering the impact on the innovation possibilities or innovation capabilities of policies in a very broad range of issues, from trade to human rights, as was pointed out before, education, technology, access to energy, many, many things. Just to conclude, I think it's a very, very important consideration that you apply a gender lens to innovation policy and to the implications of your innovation policy decisions.
Thank you. I would like to maybe save Dr. Zhang for the closing remarks part, anyway, after the session. Harsha, you have the floor.
Thank you. On gender, I completely agree, because I think basically the rules of the game don't apply the same way to different parts of gender. However, there are certain aspects where you need to also keep the social relation prevailing in the context. For example, there was one project in Africa which was focused on women entrepreneurs. And after 1 year, when the project operators went back to see how much progress had been made, each woman said what they gave was kept in the cupboard, and they asked, why didn't you use it? They said, because our man didn't tell us to do so. So, you know, I think it's a complex world, but without addressing effectively a sort of a special and differential treatment in the parlance of this house for women, full application and achievement of objectives is not possible. Research after research has shown that, and therefore one has to give special consideration to that. On Hector, your question, and the way I presented the ideas, perhaps it seemed it was a step back, but it's a combination, and I'm now talking about the traditional part. It's a vision where you actually open up 90% of trade amongst the top 30 economies from where you are looking at going forward. I think that's a major step forward. Even TPP today in the US will not go through, precisely because of market access. So we're facing problems. So how do you achieve a larger objective while addressing the concerns is the issue which I raised and tried to get a solution for. Your key questions were, can we hold the ground and how? On the first, I don't think we can, because the informalization of trade policy is moving quite rapidly. The areas where trade policy is moving into, which are becoming far more important than the areas which traditional part really looked at. You know, every writing on trade policy starts by saying tariffs are not as important today as non-tariff measures. That's a matter of fact, which doesn't mean that they are not important in order to really look at opening up and spurring world growth if you reduce them in a manner where people are comfortable in reducing them. And they do face problems. It's not for nothing that we see the world the way it is emerging. It is a reaction to the problems which have come. And those problems require solutions. Those solutions are not backward. They actually help you go forward. A car without a brake is useless. It'll only run into an accident. So this is my attempt at giving a car which moves rather than goes in another dimension, but with certain kind of brakes, which when required are applied, but under a disciplined framework. So that was what I was trying to do. Perhaps more work needs to be done there.
Thank you, Hasha. Anthony, a few words, then Dong.
Thank you very much. Yes, two quick observations. Firstly, on gender and innovation, plainly it's critically important to address it from a gender perspective. And I would analyze that in two different ways. One, just from the point of view of equity, the inclusive approach that I mentioned, this is essential for an inclusive approach. But secondly, even if one was being cold-bloodedly pragmatic, it would be folly to have an innovation policy that ignored what I would imagine is certainly more than 50% of our collective innovative capacity intellectually, and the kind of issues that Hasha mentioned are not only inequitable, but also unfortunate in terms of, you know, overall welfare from innovative capacity. This was discussed in the TRIPS Council in this very room, in fact, as one of the aspects of innovation policy that our members put on the agenda. I can't begin to encapsulate that discussion, but would refer you to the records of that meeting, which disclosed a whole range of initiatives and issues that were of concern to our members. A good example, I think, of how we can talk in terms of broad principle, yes, a very important principle, but equally to underpin that discussion through grounding it in practical experience and reported experience, analysed experience, critical to address it at both those levels. I would go further and recall that innovation is often culturally flavoured, or our perception of innovation is culturally biased or constrained. This has been one of the major issues in the discussion about traditional knowledge systems or indigenous knowledge systems here, again in the TRIPS Council in this room, but more extensively in WIPO and other multilateral fora, where an understanding that traditional knowledge systems or indigenous knowledge systems also are very important parts, are innovative systems, even if they're not perceived as such. That's exactly the issue. That's exactly the problem. And we are seeing some very exciting initiatives in that area as well. That's one point I tried to touch on very quickly in the introduction. Secondly, on the area of M2M and 3D, just an opportunistic observation that ultimately this is an area where trade in goods is evolving into trade in IP, because what are you, if we are to emerge into an economy where each consumer is a producer with a 3D printer on their desk, the trade is in the content, is in the design, is in the IP, and the transaction is a transaction concerning a right to use that data, that information. That's what an IP license is. It's nothing but an IP license. This is what Jeremy Rifkin years ago predicted, not necessarily in a complimentary way, predicted as an economy of granters of access, or what Nicholas Negroponte said, the trade in atoms would evolve into trade in bits. And we are certainly seeing that happening. Whether that requires institutional development or rewriting the rules, again, in this room, that's, I think, a vital area for discussion among our members.
Thank you, Antonio. May I request that all panelists stay in the podium, and I invite my boss, Ricardo, to join us on the podium to give a few, together with Prefect Zhang and Dongye, give some final remarks. And in the meantime, you have a feedback form in front of you on the desk. I would appreciate if you can spend a few seconds to fill that. That will help us to improve our event organization. Thank you. So, Yan, would you have a... Yes? If...
Well, thank you. Thank you, Shui Huan. Thank you all very much. I think we've exhausted time here, so I won't take time to really to summarize what has been really a fascinating morning, and particularly what we just heard, the changes and the ideas that were proposed in this last panel. They all point towards, again, how much creative thinking, open minds we need at this time to ensure, again, as I said before, the resilience of the system of rules that we have in place, how innovation, particularly on policy and institutions, may be helpful. I take the point that was made also from the floor and in the panels about how we need to be cautious in the, how innovation is introduced and then deployed in the system. But again, I'm one that thinks that it is really by adapting to the current circumstances that we can really guarantee that the system that we have in place, again, can confront the challenges that it is facing, which are very particular and many at this time. So then we also have heard very articulate and solid presentations on China's experience in its very rapid insertion into the global economy, and it's the full and gradual but full embracement of China, again, of the system of rules that in this house particularly, and how it is looking now into those challenges, particularly from the technological side. So as I said at the beginning, this is for us an opportunity to discuss issues relevant to the WTO in the context of the global trade and investment architecture. This is work that we've been doing for a number of years. We hope to continue to be able to offer more opportunities for these kind of discussions, as well as further in analysis and thought. And I'd just like to thank my colleagues at the Chinese Academy of Social Sciences, the Institute of World Politics and Economics, and thank you all for participating in the panel. Thanks.
Thank you, Ricardo. Professor Chan, can you give a final words? Thank you.
Today here, we have discussed many issues. Of course, I do not wish to summarize the points that have already been mentioned by Ricardo, because he has already provided some sound summaries of today's discussions. I believe innovation and development is a highly crucial topic. Today, we talked about innovation, in particular the two aspects of innovation, namely physical aspect, that is the material aspect of innovation, and the second is institutional innovation, because all activities are conducted by humans, and humans should be incentivized. How should we provide the accurate incentives to people. This is what institutional innovation should do. For example, institutional innovation vis-a-vis intellectual property rights, and what we have talked about, the open science concept and the institutional mechanism building. In terms of institutional innovation, I would like to mention 2 points. Number one is that we must encourage technologies to be dispersed and diffused. We have seen that a lot of research ultimately have proven that technological advancement at the material level is happening, is taking place on a daily basis. However, increasing labor productivity is not in the same pace as the advancement of technology. One of the reasons behind this is that a large majority of SMEs' technological advancement pace cannot keep up with the large enterprises that have the capabilities to do so. Therefore, I would like to emphasize that technological advancement and innovation and this diffusion of such technologies must be supported, underpinned by institutional innovation. Furthermore, I would like to talk about the issues at the financial level. This has something to do with designing of mechanisms. That is to say, when we have a good concept, how to put a concept into practice, this requires a good and sound financial market. Today, when we discuss the relationship between innovation and development, we must create an effective financial market to support innovation. I believe that in this aspect, the discussion is far from being sufficient today, and which merits further discussion in the future. In terms of development, my point of view is that development is not only about the increase in per capita income. Development should also concern the environment and the improvement in human capital, including the health situations. On the basis of which, the per capita income level increase is far more important, and this is what we need to pay more attention to. During this process, I hope that United Nations organizations, including UNESCO, have made a new indicator that is inclusive wealth. This new concept takes into account manufacturing and human capitals and natural capitals. Basically, three capitals are included. Therefore, innovation and development needs to be thought about and considered from a different perspective. And lastly, I would like to express my thanks to the organizers of today's event, ICTSD and CAS co-organized today's meeting, and this is not our first cooperation. We have actually had several similar events in the past, which have proven to be quite effective. And taking this opportunity, I would like to thank our organizers and all the participants for your support and for your contribution to the successful holding of this event. Thank you.
Of a great, very successful event, probably is a first important event in Geneva in 2017. Mm-hmm. May I invite you all to give a big round of applause to all the wonderful speakers, and also thank you for your participation. I would also like to thank two wonderful interpreters at the end of the room. Also a very professional event organizer team of ICTSD. So with this, and also special thanks to my boss, Ricardo, give guidance to the whole concept and the theme and organization of this event. With this, I adjourn this meeting. Thank you all.